As someone that follows the development of technology closely, it becomes particularly noteworthy when a seemingly obsolete technology comes back into play. This is rare. One does not often see someone switching from the latest smartphone back to a flip phone of the early 2000s. Where you would least expect this is in the area of espionage, where you might expect the highest, most advanced technology to be employed. And it is, to a degree. But at the same time, some tried and true methods from the past can be situationally brought back if the need arises, or old ones kept secret long after you'd expect, just because they work. Take one of the oldest secrets the US government kept classified until relatively recently. One of the major driving forces of classification in any government is to avoid telling everyone your methods. In this case, it was a secret held since World War I, around a century of classification. That also illustrates how classification can sometimes be rather silly. It was a recipe for disappearing ink. While one can certainly see the spy utility of disappearing ink in the past, it's hard to make a case for it today, in our days of chemical analysis, which is probably why it was declassified. But at the same time, you could order the same chemical from any magic trick supply house in the 1950s, and literally every nation on Earth knew of its existence. Yet it remained classified until relatively recently in the US. Other cases were the persistence of vacuum tubes in aircraft design by some nations far after tubes became obsolete in most contexts, except for specialist guitar amplifiers, where they hold out due to a specific sound all their own, and a few other uses. But in aircraft, a vacuum tube can make your aircraft resistant to electromagnetic pulses and do it cheaply. And it's no secret that the US nuclear arsenal still employs computer systems from the 1980s, simply because they work, and they aren't online, and can't be compromised as modern computer systems can be. If it's not broken, don't fix it. Recent world events have raised the question of why nation-states on Earth would employ very old balloon technology for espionage. The reasons usually given is that balloon technology has certain advantages over satellites, in that they can linger longer over sites. And they're inherently much cheaper. There's no way to make a highly capable spy satellite cheap. But the one thing rarely mentioned in the media is how difficult it has become to successfully operate a spy satellite, no matter its country of origin. Spy satellites have always been contentious since their advent in the space age. Rival countries can orbitally overfly each other's territory and take very high-resolution photography of strategically important sites, such as airbases. Many countries do this, and spying has been going on since time immemorial. Take the American Revolutionary War. Britain had compromised the Continental Congress with a spy, whose identity is unknown to this day. Another form of espionage in the 18th century was to intercept dispatches. One general may send a dispatch to another, only to have it intercepted and read by their adversaries, a practice not unlike the clandestine monitoring of communications that goes on today. Spying is an ancient practice, and it's actually a norm of international relations, and we all do it. So this is not to point fingers or condemn, but rather to take a global look at what's going on and what has been developing within the field of aerial and space espionage. And it's somewhat disturbing. We are truly witnessing an orbital satellite cold war. There are many ways to compromise a satellite. The most obvious is something we'd probably only ever see in wartime. Though there has been at least one recent close call that we know of. This is usually termed kinetic action, meaning a projectile is fired at a satellite with the intention of disabling or destroying it physically. This can be done from the ground or space. This sort of action is not good, and if it were widespread with satellites shooting at each other, it is one major way of setting off the Kessler syndrome, where low Earth orbit becomes unusable due to shattering space junk. Something depicted pretty inaccurately by the Sandra Bullock movie Gravity, but the basic idea is there. Kessler syndrome would create a post-conflict status quo of humanity still being able to launch satellites, but with a no-go orbital zone that you could launch through but not use. Kessler syndrome aside, kinetic action has happened in space, and actually something worse. Several countries over the years have used satellites as target practice, leading to international condemnation due to the resultant creation of space junk that will linger in orbit for long periods of time and pose a danger to active spacecraft. but that something worse involved a series of nuclear test detonations at the doorstep of space. These kinds of tests were conducted by both the Soviets and the US, and they were conducted in and around 1962. At that time, the knowledge that space was radioactive was new. In the late 1950s, University of Iowa physicist Dr. James A. Van Allen discovered that satellite-mounted Geiger counters were detecting massive amounts of radiation. These are the now famous Van Allen radiation belts, and while initially he hypothesized that they would be deadly to anything living, potentially grounding humans from ever going to space, we later collected more data, and one simply passes through these belts as quickly as possible to minimize the radiation exposure. Not having a great handle on how radiation behaves in near-Earth space, these nuclear tests were conducted and the Earth's magnetosphere did not react well. There isn't a lot of public data about some of these tests, but one in particular was known as Starfish Prime, conducted over the Pacific by the US. In addition to lighting up the sky with a blast, it created strange artificial auroras that were visible for nearly an hour all around the Pacific. And despite being almost 1,000 miles away from the blast, the electrical grid of Honolulu was partly knocked down by the test through an electromagnetic pulse, and in all ways exceeded the predictions of the scientists involved. Attempts to try to figure out how to weaponize the Van Allen radiation belts aside, there was satellite damage, and there was one curious but very unlikely satellite involved. It was known as Telstar 1. The first of a family of very successful communications satellites. This one was launched on behalf of AT&T by NASA one day after the Starfish Prime detonation. While the satellite worked, it was quickly heavily damaged by the after effects of Starfish Prime. It held on and successfully relayed everything from phone calls to TV signals, even in a hobbled condition, but only for about 7 months, when it was silenced forever by a similar Soviet high-altitude thermonuclear test. I can't imagine AT&T was too happy with that state of affairs, but in consolation, Telstar 1, though now long dead, remains in Earth orbit. A year later, US President John F. Kennedy and Soviet Premier Nikita Khrushchev signed a treaty eliminating this kind of testing. So while technically not a kinetic test of disabling a satellite, it was close. But much more recently, we've come far closer. In 2019, Russia tested an on-orbit firing of a projectile from a satellite, and has also launched satellites that have come physically close to potentially hitting US spy satellites. These were, of course, inter-nation state messages that we know little about, since such activities are invariably going to be kept as secret as possible. And the truth of these experiments is likely far more extensive on all sides. But the point is, we know that ground-based tests to destroy satellites with missiles do happen, and inter-satellite kinetic interactions are possible. But much more common are what are known as reversible interactions, where satellites can become temporarily disrupted but with no permanent damage. No doubt, these types of operations are done by anyone operating satellites. And they can include jamming. More drastic measures include microwave emissions from one satellite to another, essentially satellites cooking each other, or directed energy weapons, which have been experimented with since the Star Wars program of the Reagan era, robotic attacks, such as satellites drilling holes into each other, and even chemical spraying, where one satellite spray paints over the lens or mirror of another, or does similar chemical damage. But perhaps of the greatest interest here is satellite optical blinding. This has been going on since at least 2006 and can be done from the ground. Back then, there were reports of satellites being lit up by ground-based sources, and while they didn't really affect the day-to-day intelligence functions of those satellites, it was clear that there would come a time when they would, and now it's happening constantly. And hitting targets with lasers is not new. The Apollo missions to the moon set up meter-sized reflectors, so lasers from Earth could be used to very accurately determine the distance to the moon at any given time. But there's more. The US Space Force, for example, has recently taken over equipment, the existence of which is not classified, that interferes directly with satellite downlinks and uplinks. Typically called the newly created force's first offensive weapons system, the CCS, or Counter Communications System, allows essentially for satellite signal jamming from the ground. And there's always the cyber warfare and hacking component. While there have been many calls, rightfully, to avoid the weaponization of space, the reality is that it's been weaponized for years now. But we also stand at the cusp of the democratization of space with tourism, and eventually civilians of many nations living and working in space. That could work out peacefully if we play our cards right, or it could lead to nightmare scenario O'Neill cylinder laser wars, the formation of new independent orbital states that may not agree with each other or those on Earth, and so on. I truly hope that as a species we find some way of leaving our baggage here on Earth and simply existing as the humans when in space, and actually make ourselves presentable to any alien species we may ever come across. But at this point, spy satellites, at least some types of them, may be of severely limited effectiveness in certain circumstances. And because of that, it's not unreasonable to expect nation states employing different means of practicing aerial espionage, even if they might on their face seem archaic. It's much easier to take a bet on a cheap balloon returning something useful as far as intelligence gathering is concerned, than launching a very expensive spy satellite that may not end up working. For better or worse, here may come the new age of the balloons, and perhaps even the return of the strategic airships, at least for now. There's an effect known as photophoresis, where a suitable object can absorb sunlight, while the other side does not, creating a temperature difference. This can have the effect of creating a lifting force on a very light, specifically designed object. Thus, superlight objects could be designed to float indefinitely in the upper atmosphere of Earth, but also Mars and Venus and possibly beyond, that take advantage of the effect and carry tiny microscopic payloads. These types of objects, which are being studied, could be released into the atmosphere using standard weather balloons. While ostensibly being developed for weather and scientific study, it's not hard to see how such a device could in the future be used for espionage, and would be almost impossible to detect by radar due to their size. A brave new world indeed is coming. Thanks for listening. I'm futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently expecting balloon encounters from all sides for talking about this. There's a show that once aired on British television called The Prisoner, where Patrick McGoohan was imprisoned on an island for some reason, and every time he tried to leave, he got attacked by a weather balloon. That's just what I need, a quantum mechanical possum, a difficult AI, and sentient attacking weather balloons every time I go outside. Not good. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.